Welcome back, everybody. Today I am just going to show you that the VirtualBox guest editions have indeed installed and the machine has indeed booted. So here it is, Red Hat Virtual Machine. I have switched it to full screen mode. If I just go ahead and tick this, there we go. So it says view here. I can switch it to full screen if I wish to do so, so you don't see any of the differences, so you don't see the VirtualBox lines and toolbar. Anyway, so let me just go ahead and minimize it a little bit. The first time when you boot it up like this, when you log in, what I've noticed and what I've noticed with my previous virtual machines is that the VirtualBox guest editions don't load up immediately. So log in, wait maybe 15 seconds, a bit more, maybe 20, something like that, for them to load. Try resizing your screen like this. Pretty sure that that doesn't have that much effect, but something seems to be reloading in the background, and it does help out the way I've noticed it. Apparently here it has broke. I have broken something. Have I indeed broken something? No, I haven't. It does work. Perhaps the screen just blanked out or something like that. I could not switch the monitor configuration. Okay, so this is not a big deal here. Anyway, as I said, just try resizing the screen, wait for about 20 seconds or so, and the VirtualBox guest editions will inevitably load, or should load anyway. Now, in this tutorial, what I wanted to do with you is show you how you can actually perform a dual boot of Windows 8.1 and Red Hat. Now, this is only valid for Windows 8.1 and Windows 8. You're not going to have such difficulties with Windows 7 or Vista or XP or anything of a kind. If you by any chance happen to have any of those operating systems, and if you wish to perform a dual boot, please do post it in the discussions. I will be more than happy to help you out and to give you detailed instructions on how to do that, as that is a lot simpler. But the procedure is pretty much the same. Anyway, so as I said, I will show you three ways how you can set up your environment. One I have already shown to you, how to use VirtualBox and how to install it. The second one will be how to dual boot, how to perform a dual boot between Windows 8.1 and Red Hat. And the third one we will do way later on when I show you the virtualization process, the one that I talked about where you get 95% native performance with Xen. I do not want to get into that with you now, primarily because I wish to go over the graphical user interface of Linux, Red Hat, and I wish to introduce you to the Linux command line and a few other things before we actually get into that, because that is a bit complicated and there are a lot of new stuff there, so I'm just afraid that a lot of people won't be able to follow it through. So for the time being, let's stick to the basics and we will later on move on to the more advanced stuff. Anyway, I'm just going to go ahead and minimize this machine. So this is my Windows 8.1 machine. Let me just go ahead and boot it up. And yep, there we go. So it is booting, no problems, hopefully. Yep, there we go. I thought I forgot a CD inside or something of a kind, but no, indeed, Windows 8.1 should boot up. I don't know, the boot process for Windows is fairly slow from what I've seen, but doesn't really matter. I'm gonna try assigning more resources to this machine because I'm gonna I didn't actually do this the proper way. See advanced, continue. You shouldn't actually see this, but anyway, I seem to have been messing around with the machine a little bit, so to say, and it's offering me to actually perform a repair, but I don't really need a repair. It's gonna boot up no problems now. Anyway, I am doing the demonstration in VirtualBox, of course, in a virtualized environment, but the procedure is exactly the same with the real machines. Although there is a downside to this. For this particular method, you will require two hard drives, and this is basically a foolproof method that will work on pretty much any device out there, as opposed to some other methods where you do it in a single drive and then encounter a ton load of problems, because I've seen so many people complain on so many forums out there how Windows 8.1 doesn't play well with other operating systems at all. So I've decided against showing you other methods, primarily because a lot of problems were experienced by a lot of people using those methods. So I just figured I would show you the foolproof one, the one that is safe, the one that leaves you with the lowest chance of messing anything up. Anyway, so this is my Windows 8.1 machine. It is up and running. So this would be an equivalent of your physical machine. And I'm just gonna go ahead and power it off for the time being because I don't really need it or want it at the time. I wish to install another one. As before, so just shut it down. And as before, you will of course need an ISO file of the operating system, which you will burn to a CD. Once you have burned it to a CD, just insert the CD into your machine and boot from it. Here's how you do it. So on a VirtualBox, I'll of course use virtual things in a virtualized environment. But basically, you see this, where the one that I've selected now, it says controller IDE, it says here empty. Now if I just select, where is it? There we go. If I just select it, it's an equivalent of you inserting a CD. When I selected this ISO file, it's like, it's an equivalent of you inserting a CD, an installation CD into your machine and running the installation from there. Anyway, I'm just gonna click here OK, and your systems should be configured by default to boot from a CD, so you don't have to worry about that. If there are not, it's gonna be written in the bottom right corner. Anyway, it's gonna be written there anyway, like press F12 or Del or F2 or something of a kind to get the boot configuration or boot setup running. And once you actually press one of those buttons, it gives you an option like, would you like to boot from a CD, would you like to boot from a hard drive, from a USB, or from network. Just use up and down arrow keys to select the one that you want and press enter. That is literally all you need to do. I, in the virtualized environment, actually needed to do what I just did. Now, there is another thing that I will do here that you do not need to do in the real world. You see, I have actually created a virtual hard drive, another one. So you do need two hard drives. See, one I have named Windows 8.1 VD.VD, and another one is Red Hat.VDI. Anyway, if you are doing this, and by any chance, if you're curious, or if you want to do this in the virtual box, you just press add the, add a CD or DVD device, add a hard drive. There we go. And then you can say create a new disk or choose an existing disk. If you say create a new disk, it takes you through this process. You just basically click next, allot the size, change the name, and click create. That is literally all, and it will create it. We'll create one just like this one if you named it so as well. Anyway, not that important at all for you because you'll be running this on a physical machine. This is a process for a physical machine, so dual booting Windows 8.1 and Red Hat on two hard drives. Anyway, just go ahead and power on the machine now that you have the CD has been previously inserted before the restart. And there we go. We're immediately prompted for an option to actually install Red Hat Enterprise. We can just go ahead and select it. That's the first option, not the default one though, because it first offers a testing of a media. You can run the test if you want as well, but I don't think that there is that much of a need. The burning software today is relatively good and performs a lot of checkups itself. And the installation process is en route. I'm not gonna go through it in great detail as I have shown it to you already before, but there is one segment which I do wish to show you and which I do wish to explain further, so to say. That would be the partitioning play. That would be the partitioning. There, it is okay to select an automatic partitioning scheme if you are using a single operating system or if you're just installing it onto an empty drive in a virtualized environment, something of a kind. It can be a quick workaround. But what you really want to do is be able to partition it yourself during the installation procedure as well. That can be very, very nice, primarily because you can do whatever you want with it. You can create a scheme that will suit your needs, that will benefit you, that you have deemed appropriate to yourself. Now we have one disk here. It says ATA VBox hard disk. This is where the Windows is located physically. You can see it says only 3000 kilobytes of free space. Right next to it I have a hard disk. It says almost 100. What? Oh, okay, this is I've already ran an installation on this, but you can see it says here SDA and SDB, and then you have the amount of space that is free on it. Anyway, they're both 100 gigs. I'm sure that on your machine they won't be exactly 100 gigs each one of them. Make sure to first figure out which disk you want to use. So if your Windows is installed on one disk, don't install it there, install it on another disk. I'm not talking about partitions here, I'm talking about two separate hard drives that are within your machine. So just go ahead and select the one that is that you have chosen. It's not empty, there's something on it, I don't know, some things that I have previously installed, but doesn't really matter. I'm just gonna go ahead and select it. Please be very careful also when doing this, because if you format the drive, you're gonna lose information, that you're gonna lose data, you're not gonna be able to recover it to the fullest of extents. Some of it you will be able to retrieve, but this is not Windows partitioning or something like that. Once you delete things with Linux, it's rather difficult to restore them. Even when I delete something in my terminal with an rm command, it's gone. You just learn to live with it. Anyway, so as I said once again, I can't emphasize this enough. Please select the proper hard disk. If you have problems selecting the proper hard drive, feel free to post it in the discussions. I will be more than happy to help you out with it, but please do not just randomly click on stuff and lose your data. Anyway, to select the drive, all you need to do is click on it, and this mark appears. You see this one, it appears now, and then when I click on it, it disappears. Excellent. So I have selected the second drive, and I want to select I will configure partitioning, that option. Excellent. So now we click on done, and we're going to be thrown here where we're given an opportunity to actually set it up ourselves. So I already have this, and oh, I have already installed Red Hat here previously, so let's just go ahead and delete it all, since I'm not interested in that now. I wish to do it from scratch so that you can actually see how it is done. So we can have standard partitions, we can have Linux Volume Manager, and some other things as well, but I'm just going to go ahead and select standard partitioning for this. I could actually even select an LVM. And the first partition that we need to configure is root. Your system files will be located there. So I need to desired capacity, let's say 20 gigs. So 20 GB. Add mount point. Excellent. It is created now. I can encrypt it if I wish. Yeah, you can create volume groups as well, because Linux generally, if you have a bunch of disks running under Linux, it just sees them, it can actually see them as a single hard drive. So it treats, I don't know, 2, 3, 4 disks as a single hard drive, no problems. You get that with the default installations of Linux, which is very nice. And if you go back to the root directory in Linux, you will always go back to root. While going back to the root directory on Windows usually means going selecting a disk where it is installed, like C or something like that, and then going there. If this is unclear to you now, I don't want you to worry about it at all. As we move in deeper and deeper, when I give you clear examples of this, you will understand it far better. Anyway, we have created the root partition, and now we need to create a boot partition for our Red Hat. So add mount, wait. Okay, so it gave it the automatic size of 81 gigabytes because I haven't assigned any size to it, which is a bit funny. So let's just go ahead and delete that, and let's create it again. So boot, let's say, I don't know, you can probably get away with 500, with 100 megs, but I'm just going to say 500 megs to be certain, because, I don't know, I guess I'm a cautious guy, and I have a lot of space here. Literally, I can have, like, more space than I will probably ever need on this laptop. Anyway, so boot root, and now we need home. So home is not, I mean, I don't think you shouldn't get any errors, but you should definitely create a home partition. So 80, and yeah, sure, why not, 80 GB. Pretty sure it's not gonna need a space there. Excellent. Also, you will notice that it doesn't actually obey me to the fullest of extents. It creates a, I've told it 80, and it has created 74.51. Anyway, that's just how it works. I have a bit of available space left here, and I figured, why not? Let's create a swap partition. So swap, actually, you don't need to create it, I think I mentioned this, but it's not a bad idea to have it. You're not gonna get an error message, but you're gonna get a warning message, let's put it so. Anyway, I didn't put in any size parameters, so it just took pretty much all that it could take. There's like 1 megabyte that's gonna be left there. I suppose you can try tweaking and being extremely precise and trying to extract this 1 megabyte, but honestly, why bother? Anyway, you can put in a label here, you can name it any way you like as well, and no problems there. Swap will only act as a, usually you put it twice the size of RAM, but I mean on modern systems you don't really need it, primarily because you're not gonna run out of RAM generally, but you might, and then your system actually starts using your portion of your hard drive as it would use RAM. It's a really slow procedure. The method is terrible, but hey, it saves the day when all is taken into consideration. Anyway, I'm just gonna click here. I got home, boot, root, swap. I'm gonna say done. And here I get a summary of changes. I get a type and what's gonna be destroyed, what's gonna be created. Just have a look at this and make sure none of these disks are reserved for your Windows. So you can see by SDB, if any of them was SDA, cancel this immediately, but no, they're all SDB. Excellent, so it's the second physical hard drive. They're usually SDB, SDA, I think the next one should be SDC, and so on and so forth, depending on how many you have. So here it says what's going to be created, what's going to be destroyed, what's going to be formatted, etc. So let's just go ahead and click on accept changes, and there you go, custom partitioning selected, all is ready, and the installation may actually begin. So you just click on begin installation. I didn't connect it to the network, but doesn't really matter, we can do all the updates and all the things later on that we actually want, since we will need to install some software and perform the updates as well. Anyway, I shall leave you here, and later on I'll just show you that this, how the system boots and how and what is the difference between how do you actually select to boot into Windows and how do you actually select to boot into Red Hat. Anyway, until then, I bid you farewell.